Okay, so last class we started doing a design example of a two-stage op amp with pole splitting compensation. Okay, so the example we picked was we chose a case with requiring gain of 80 dB. Then the unity gain frequency was 5 megahertz. Output peak-to-peak voltage was 4 volts, phase margin was 60 degrees, and slew rate was 10 microseconds. Those are the minimum specs. If you get better than this, good, well and good, right? And of course, you are given the device level specs, right? You are given VDD is 5 volts, VT is 1 volt, Lmin, lambda L was given. Load, the big important thing is load capacitance of 10 picofarad, right? You have to drive that capacitance. And you also have to see, once you design, you'll need to make sure that all your assumptions are correct. So that's where we stopped. So we started off with the slew rate, because it seems like current is an important thing to settle, right? It seems like you have to, once you set the current, then you can move on to setting the widths and so on. And you can, and all these things are variable, right? This is a first cut design. So we first set the current based on the slew rate, okay? Then we set the compensation capacitance, rather the other way around, sorry. We first set the compensation capacitance, because of course compensation capacitance determines the slew rate also. So we set the compensation capacitance based on the phase margin, okay? Obviously, because if you have a larger compensation capacitance, right, you are naturally going to have better phase margin. That's what you would expect, at least. Correct? And next you use your slew rate to set the current. So for now, so as a starting point, we assumed that both input and output currents limit the slew rate. In reality, you may need slightly larger than this, but for a first cut design, this is perfectly fine. Okay? Next we looked at, based on the unity gain frequency of 5 megahertz, we found out GM1, we know the current through transistors 1 and 2, so we set W over L of 1, right? So what did we find? We found out that the current through the first stage was 25 microamps, current through the second stage was 125 microamps, the compensation capacitance was 1/4, which is 2.5 picofarads, correct? And then you got W over L1 is approximately 5. Then based on the output swing, we started off assuming that the VDSAT is 0.5 volts, so that you have 0.5 on top, 0.5 on bottom, and so you have a 4 volt swing. Is that right? Okay. So based on that, we set it for 6 and 7 so far. So if I go back to the, we set it for this guy and this guy. Okay, but then we know once we set it for M7, M5 and M8 will also have the same VDSAT because it's a current mirror. Okay, and then for now we also set M3 and M4 to have the same VDSAT, even though that we decided it wasn't set in stone, right, because it really doesn't affect a lot of things. Okay. So we assume that all VDSATs are 0.5. And then from there we got W over L of 7, 6 and of course 3/4 and 5 and 8. Okay? We found all of these things. Right? Okay. After that we proceeded to the last spec, which was the DC gain. Okay? We took care of phase margin, we took care of unity gain frequency, took care of output voltage swing. Next is DC gain. What is the DC gain? It's the gain of the first stage times the gain of the second stage. Gain of the first stage is just GM1 times GM1 over GDS2 plus GDS4. Okay? Times gain of the second stage is A2, which is nothing but GM6 times GM6 over GDS6 plus GDS7. Right? Is that right? Okay. So based on that, what we did is, this time, unlike last time, we, you know, we wanted a particular RDS, from that we back calculated lambda and then the length. Here we'll directly calculate the lambda itself, okay, because we know GDS in terms of lambda, so you could do the same thing the other case also. So then we got it in terms of lambda, and now we can set a, constraint that all lambdas have to be equal, so that you get, in reality, the one only constraint we have to set is that lambda 2 equals lambda 4 and lambda 6 equals lambda 7. We don't have to set all of them to have the same lambda, but we'll set it to start off with. Okay? And then we found out that lambda is 2.5 e minus 2. Okay? What is the next step? Yeah. We know lambda n ln is 0.04. This will give you ln. Okay? In this particular case, it gives you 1.6. So what length would you choose? Well, in this particular case, 2 microns, because L minimum is 2 microns. You can't do 1.6 in this particular technology, right? So of course, okay? So that means you'll actually get slightly larger R out. Okay, but that's okay. That only means you'll increase your gain. What did I give this as? I think I gave it as 0.1. Right? I think you get something like 3.98 or something. So choose LP equals 4. Okay? So now your first cut design is complete. You know all the W over L's. So you know also the L's. You know the currents. You know the composition capacitance. You pretty much know everything. So now it's such, you know, the next step is to start checking your assumptions, right? Because yesterday people were talking about, whether GM6 is not, 10 times and so on, right? So we'll take a look at that. The way I would do it is I would go through this whole thing once and then go back to check my assumptions. But if you do it, halfway through, that's fine. You'll be doing some iteration loops inside, okay? The way I do it is I go, I complete the design once and for all and then go back and check my assumption. You can do it either way. In this particular case, GM1 was 78.5. What is GM6? Anybody? 500 microsiemens. So of course it is not 10 times, it is some 6 times or something. Okay? So now you need to increase. Okay? How do you increase it? So one option is to increase IB. Okay? What happens if you increase IB? So, first, obviously, bad effect is, so VDSAT6 will also increase as you increase I. Okay? What else happens? What else does IB affect? Slew rate. What happens to slew rate? Gets better. Right? So, that is not a problem. What else does it affect? What else does increasing IB affect? Sure, VDSAT of M7. So you'll have to change that also. Okay? Anything else? Gain. Right? Fundamentally it changes the gain. You're increasing GM6. But it improves it. So well and good. Okay? So it's not a major problem. So now obviously VDSAT you set it to 0.5. You need to improve that. So what would you do? You would increase W over L of 6. By the same amount. If you're doubling IB, you would have to double WRL of 6 also to keep the same VDSAT. Correct? The same current density will give you the same VDSAT. Okay? So you need to find out how much you need to increase GM by, and appropriately increasing IB will increase GM, increasing WRL 6 will also increase GM. You need to find out how much you are going to increase it by, that's all. Okay? Okay, so this is the bad effect. So suppose you increase WRL of 6. What is that effect? Parasitic capacitance, where? Definitely, yeah, parasitic capacitance. One is at the output node, Vout. Okay? The other is at Vx. Is that right? At these two points, it increases the parasitic capacitance. What is the total capacitance at Vout? CL plus CdB6 plus CdB7 plus you have some component from plus CC, of course, right? Plus some component from CGD and so on, we'll ignore for now, right? So CL plus CC would be 12.5 picofarad. So you have to be careful. It depends on how much the parasitic capacitance increases by. Right? As long as it's small compared to this, that's fine. Okay? What about the increase in capacitance at CX, at VX? What does that do? So of course, if you increase WRL of 6 at X, at node X, you will have a larger capacitance. What will that do? It will make your non-dominant pole smaller. Are you sure? What is the dominant pole in this case? First of all, where is the dominant pole? At the output of the first stage, right? Why is that? Because you are using a Miller capacitance, right? So the dominant pole is at the output of the first stage. So what happens if the capacitance there increases? So you are going to pull in your unity gain frequency slightly, but now since that the total capacitance there is the gain of the second stage times CC. So even if it becomes a little bit larger, you probably don't mind too much. What is that? Can somebody calculate and tell me what the capacitance there is at Vx? What is the Miller capacitance? You have all the numbers, right? You need to calculate. Anybody? One sixty times six. 160 times CC. Okay, what is that? Something like 400 picofarads. Is that right? Can anybody else confirm that? What did you do? I assume you just took GM6 over GDS6 plus GDS7, right? Times CC, right? Okay, so let's assume it's some 400 picofarad, okay? So in which case, you know, increasing it even by a few picofarads is not going to appreciably change things. Okay? Okay. So looks like doing a combination of, you know, increasing IB and increasing W over L6 is probably okay. Okay? That is the conclusion. Okay, what is the next check we need to do? So we did one thing, right? GM6 greater than or equal to 10 GM1. What condition is that? 0 is very far away. Okay? What else? What other poles are there in the system? You also need to check the output pole. Right? That is the non-dominant pole. Okay? Okay, so you can check that. Okay, so I am not going to do that now. So let us say you check it. And of course you cannot change CL. Right? So now the only other thing you can probably change is the output impedance at that node. Right? You can't do much about that. Okay, what else? Are there any other poles? When we started off doing this two-stage op amp, let me go back. Okay, so when we started off doing this two-stage op amp, we assumed there is a parasitic capacitance C1, parasitic capacitance is the output C2, then we assume that CC is your dominant Miller capacitance. Right? Looks like we have considered all of that. At the input you will have C1 plus, you know, the gain of the second stage times CF. At the output we have done that. Okay? Let's assume you have done that also. Anything else? We have missed out. So, based on this, right, this simplistic model, we saw there are only two poles and the two poles split, right? One becomes the dominant, other moves out. Anything else? Anything else? Which one? Exactly. So we didn't consider that at all. Right? You also have a mirror pole. Remember we looked at this a long time ago. Right? What is the value of this mirror pole? Where is it located? GM3 by CGS3 plus CGS4, correct? Okay. So now that you know W's and L's, can you calculate that? What, can one of you calculate that? Or all of you? Not one of you. I want all of you to calculate it. So these are the widths and widths. All the NMOSes have 2 microns, all the PMOSes have 4 micron length. Okay? And these are the W over L's. Can somebody calculate CG? Okay. First of all, of course, you need to know COX. Okay? In reality, you would go to the, you know, model file, pick out TOX. Okay? Epsilon R, epsilon R over TOX would give you COX. Okay? But suppose I tell you, it's 6 femtofarads per micron squared. Let us say I give you a number like this. I mean, in reality, you'll calculate it out, but these are all anyways for the design example, they're made up numbers, right? So suppose I tell you, the oxide capacitance is 6 femtofarad per micron squared. Can you calculate that pole, the position of that pole? Go ahead and calculate it, Jayant.
What is it? Yes. First of all, what is CTS?
What is it? No. What is the expression for CGS? 2/3 WLCR. Right? Is everybody using that? Don't use half. Half WLCR is for a transistor in triode region. Okay? What is it? Is that right? 7.5 megahertz? I got a different number. Huh? 0.195. I'm hearing lots of different numbers. Okay. Are you doing mega radians per second or megahertz? You first have to decide that. Right? GM over C at the point will give you radians per second. Okay. You have to divide it over 2 pi to get megahertz. Okay. So what did you get? 7.5 megahertz. Okay. You are getting 0.03 megahertz. Okay. What is GM3? 17 or 70? 70 microsiemens. Okay. Let's assume that. I don't know the answer. So let's say. So a lot of people are saying 70 microsiemens. Everybody is agreed on that? Okay. What is this? 2/3 16 times 4 times 6. Right? What is, I don't have my calculator. Is this what you did? Right? 50. Did you use IA over 2 or did you use IA for the bias current? IA over 2. Right? So it's 12.5 microamps. Is a bias current you have to use for calculating GM. So you're 70 or 50? 70. Okay, I see a lot more 70, so I'll assume that's right. Okay, why don't you check yours? Well, lot more as in I'm hearing 2 instead of 1, right? That's all it is. Sorry? 60 minus? Oh, yeah. Sorry. 60 minus 15. Huh? Okay. What is it? Oh, mu PCOX. Okay. Yeah, that is the other thing. You have to use mu PCOX. Right? Mu PCOX is 25. 50. Okay. And if you do this and divide by 2 pi, you're telling me it's 0.03 megahertz?
Yeah.
Okay, what is that? 30 megahertz. Is everybody getting that? 30 megahertz? Rakshit? Huh? Oh, you don't have a calculator. Okay. Can somebody come up with the right answer? Well, confirm that it is 30, right? Okay, that's better, right? So, this is what you should be getting, somewhere like 15.5. Okay, so this is only approximately what, 3 times FU, right? It's only something like 3 times the unity gain frequency. So of course you have a problem. What do you do? So now this is the non-dominant pole. What do you do? What would you do to... So you told me it is GM3 over 2CGS3. So suppose you want to reduce this. So this, in this case it's some 15 megahertz, right? Sorry? You're getting 155. Okay, that means you're... well, because I did this earlier and I got 15. Okay, so maybe I've made a mistake if I did it quite fast. Are you getting 50 my... Okay, so... Well, I don't want to sit down and calculate it now, okay? So, I've already given time for you guys. Okay, why don't you sort this out? Okay, go back, all of you go back and check this. And find out whether it's 15 or 150 megahertz. Okay? Let's assume for now it's 15. Okay? And then we'll see what needs to be done. So, if it is 15, what would you do? Increase GM3. How do you increase GM3? Can you increase W over L of 3? Why not? Why? CGS is proportional to W, GM is proportional to root of W, right? So of course you don't want to increase width. So the only other method left to you is to increase the current. Right? Okay? Suppose you increase the current, what happens? GM1 will what? Will increase. It's not a problem. Right? GM1 mainly affects the gain. Also, it affects the non-dominant pole. Sorry, the dominant pole. Right? Now you'll have to be careful about that. You might have to change the size of W or L of GM. Okay? But of course, if you increase current, if GM1 increases, your non-dominant pole will increase by the same amount as GM3 if you increase the current. So they're actually moving together. Huh? Of course. Right? So what you'll have to do is you have to change the size of WRL of 1 also correspondingly to keep that GM constant. Sorry? Yeah, that's what I said. Omega U will increase, but now so both are moving together. Right? What you want to do is move this non-dominant pole relative to omega U. Right? So if you just increase the current without doing anything else, both of them will move by the same amount. Right? So you not only have to increase the current, you also have to decrease the size of WRL of 1 to keep the omega U where it is. Right? Is that right? What does that do? Okay. So what is changing VDSAT of M1, what does it do? It will change the input common mode range. Okay? Okay. That's the third check we need to do to find out what your input common mode range is. Okay? I'll call it VIC. What is the minimum input common mode range? Let's go back to your figure. What is, let us say, VIC is the input common mode. So you have VIC plus some signal. What is the minimum value of VIC? VGS1 plus VDSAT5. Okay? What is that in this case? You don't even need to calculate it. You already know that. Yeah, assume we have not changed any W over L, right? We are just going to calculate it out. Yeah, we have made all the VDSATs the same. And VDS1 is nothing but VT plus VDSAT1. Right now VDSAT1 is also 0.5. We have not changed that. So it's actually 2 volts. What is VIC max? VDD minus VSG3 plus VT. Right? Is that right? What is that? What is it? Okay. It's 4.5 volts. So in this particular case, your input common mode range is between 2 and 4.5 volts. Okay? I didn't give a particular spec here, but what is VDSAT? Why is it VDSAT 3? Look at it again. Right? Yeah, you have a diode there, diode connector transistor there. Okay? Okay, so now you are pretty much done with the first cut design, let's say. So now of course you need to go back and check your assumptions and all that, iterate, all that. Okay? The next step would be probably go to the simulator, like try to refine it by hand. Then next step, go to the simulator and that will take into account all your non-idealities. Right? You have assumed so many things. You have assumed that VTs are constant, you have assumed that output impedances, lambda doesn't depends only on length, all those things, and you have assumed that actually lambda L is constant, that is true over a small range, typically close to L min, right? If you move very far away from L min, that is also not true. Okay, so there are lots of things which will change once you go to the simulator. But that's the, you know, more accurate way of doing it. Okay? Okay, so we are done with MOS op-amps. Any questions? Amit, any questions? Lots of them. Okay, so by the way, I mean I had not announced any office hours, but if I had specifically mentioned on the website, I mentioned in the first class, if anyone wants to come and meet me, yeah, just call me, email me, set up a time to come and meet me. I'm willing to, you know, I'll be glad to discuss anything you want outside class. Okay? Okay, so we finished studying MOS op-amps, right? So the biggest, okay, so there is of course lots of differences between the devices as such, right? But fundamentally what you'll see is MOS op-amps, at least the way they are nowadays, are designed, are typically custom designs, right? They are designed for application in a specific kind of circuit, okay? And your specs actually come from that. Now the next, the bipolar op-amp we are going to study is more of a general purpose op-amp. Okay, so this is called, the one we are going to study is called the 741. So it is a fairly standardized op-amp structure. It has a lot of interesting things, that's why we need to study it, right? Even though we spent like almost a month on MOS op-amps, we'll spend maybe 3 classes on bipolar op-amps, okay, to get a basic idea of what the differences are and, you know, what techniques are used, okay? So first of all, one big difference, okay, between MOSFETs and bipolars is the technology itself that is used. So first of all, if you just look at MOSFETs, what is the big difference between NMOSFETs and PMOSFETs? Mu N and mu P, okay, anything else? That's the difference in speed, yes, fundamentally. Anything else? PMOS? N-well, okay, yeah, apart from that, yeah, it's put in an N-well, that is as far as the device is concerned. But suppose you look at just if you just look at the performance of the circuit itself, Is there any big difference apart from mu and mu p? Actually not a lot, right? To compensate for mu and mu p, you might have to make the PMOS maybe twice as large or something, right? Maybe thrice as large. Apart from that, so PMOSes are a little bit slower than NMOSes. Okay, for the same GM, your CGS will be larger. Okay, but apart from those two, there is not a lot of difference. Yeah, you could have a small slight change in difference in VT. One maybe 0.7, other maybe 0.6 or something like that. Those are all very small differences. However, if you look fundamentally at bipolars, okay, there is actually a big difference between NPNs and PNPs. So let's see, I have an isolation. This is of course your this thing. Okay, lose your N epi. Sorry. Okay. So this is a typical structure of a an NPN transistor. So what does it have? So it has N plus emitter. Surrounding that, right, you have an N plus emitter. Surrounding that on all directions you have the base. And then surrounding that you have the collector. So fundamentally it's a vertical device. Okay? And this is your base width. So fundamentally what you are trying to do is catch all of your emitter current, right? So in this case emitter is emitting electrons, you are trying to capture all of it at the collector, correct? So you have, for example, a transit time associated with the electron moving through this base width, okay? In other words, you have some capacitance associated with it. So that will decide how fast the transistor is. The thickness of your base width is going to determine, in other words, how fast your transistor is. Okay? So this is your NPN. Okay? This is your vertical transistor. Now when you look at in the same technology, if you look at a PNP, so I don't want to redraw all of this, so I'm just going to erase some of this and draw it. Maybe not. Just draw it again. Okay, this is what your PNP transistor looks like. So this is actually called a lateral PNP. Okay, in the NPN transistor the current flow is vertical. In the case of this device, the current flow is actually, the current direction is this way, electrons go the other way. Current direction is horizontal. Okay. And this device is fundamentally slower, okay, so and low gain. Okay, why is it slower? In the case of the vertical transistor, your base width is determined only by diffusion, right? So you can make it much smaller then you would actually make a lateral distance. Okay, lateral distance is determined by photolithography. Okay, and that depends on the wavelength of light and so on. So to make it smaller is more difficult. Whereas base width, you can control it much greater accuracy, and you can actually make it much smaller. Okay, so that is why it's faster. Why is it low gain? You are trying to capture all the current, all the electrons which is being emitted by the emitter. Okay, in the case of the vertical transistor, your base completely surrounds your collector, and then it has to pass through a very narrow junction, and then it's captured by the collector. In this case, you can have you have other currents, you have vertical currents, for example. All those things are not captured. Now you can make this device better, we'll look at it next class, but there are ways to make it slightly better, so some layout ways, so we'll look at that next class. But the basic idea is, you don't capture all the current, so your alpha is low, your beta is low. You know what alpha is for a bipolar transistor? What is it? IC by IE, right? You want it to be as close to 1 as possible. If beta is very large, alpha will be 1, right? So very close to 1, okay? Yes. Okay. That is because of primarily because of cost. Okay, the minute you want to have a vertical PNP, the process gets much more expensive. It's not that simple. For a bipolar, it's not that simple. For a MOSFET, it is like that. For a bipolar, it's not that simple. Okay. Okay. So maybe what we'll do is we'll stop here. Okay, I think this is a good point. Just